My name is Lucia Marco, and I am the song leader at WHCC. I will be leading you through some songs during service, and the first song we're going to be singing together is I Woke Up This Morning. So let's go ahead and sing together, warm up our hearts, and get ready for service. Good morning, my name is Lucia Marco and
Good morning, Lucia, and thank you so much for getting us started this morning. For those who may not know me, I'm Craig Peterson, senior pastor here at Woodland Hills Community Church, and we're thrilled to have you with us this morning. For those who might be joining on Facebook Live or YouTube Live for the first time, let me say this about the community you've joined this day. Woodland Hills Community Church is blessed with a clear three-dimensional sense of who we are. We are many things, including, number one, a just peace congregation, where peace is a core and defining value, both interpersonally as well as internationally. We are a progressive Christian church that believes or embraces a faith informed by head, by heart, and by spirit, a faith where you don't have to denigrate or deny the faith of another or another faith tradition in order to follow Jesus. And finally, we are an open and affirming community that celebrates the sacred value of each person in their authentic self. So please be nothing other than yourself in this sacred space today. While we're unique in some ways, we are part of an umbrella of churches numbering nearly 5,000 called the United Church of Christ. We proclaim a gospel message that says, no matter who you are or where you are on life's journey, you are welcome here. Now, the year 2022 marks the 75th year of ministry for our community. And in year number 14, something very special happened 61 years ago yesterday. On that Sunday, a young minister who was celebrating his 33rd birthday was our guest preacher that day, and you might have heard of him. His name was Martin Luther King Jr. He had been invited a year and a half earlier by the pastor at the time, and we were thrilled to welcome him that day. He spoke at two services that day, and then that evening he spoke at Canoga Park High School as well. So today we celebrate the dream that Dr. King shared with us personally, and we use this time of worship to celebrate the ways we can keep that dream alive. Now today, as you heard in the second gathering song, one of the great ironies is in the movement for social justice, if we're not careful, we can easily adopt language that's usually used in war. We can use words like fight and battle. But as a just peace congregation that looks about how we can change the world, not just in our cause, but the ways in which we work for it, in today's service, you're not going to hear much battle language. Instead, you're going to hear words like joy, unity, love, and inclusion as we celebrate the vision that Christ and Dr. King laid out for us. So having said that, today I'm going to invite our lay reader for today, a young man by the name of Ethan, to join us. And Ethan will lead you, the worshiping community, in your responsive portions of the call to worship. So with that, Ethan and I will now lead you in the call to worship. I want to pause for a moment and make sure that Ethan is there with me. All right. I'm here. Our mother and father God has made us to be one body with many members.
United and uniting, this is our calling.
God calls us to share our diverse gifts, activated by the one and the same Spirit.
United and uniting, this is our redemption.
God longs for us to be united in love and to manifest the Spirit in our different ways.
United and uniting, this is our worship.
So let us gather in this hour to offer praise and celebration to our holy God,
who challenges us and calls us to create the beloved community.
And as we celebrate each and every member of the beloved community, we're going to open today with a song that has come to be known as the Black National Anthem, a song called Lift Every Voice and Sing. And in the days following some of the violence these past 2 years, organizations like the National Basketball Association played both the national anthem as well as this song we're about to sing as a show of unity. So let us join together and sing, Lift Every Voice and Sing.
Facing the rising sun of our new day, be march on till victory is won. Stony the road we trod, bitter the chastening rod, felt in the days when hope unborn had died. Yet with a steady beat, have not our weary feet come to the place for which our people sighed. We have come over a way that with tears has been watered. We have come treading our path through the blood of the slaughtered. How from the gloomy past till now we stand at last where the white gleam of our bright star is cast. God of our weary years, God of our silent tears, God who has brought our God where we met you, lest our hearts drunk with the wine of the world forget you. Shadow beneath your hand, may we forever stand true to our God, true to our native land.
And now let's bring the children forward for our children's time. Let's sing This Little Light of Mine.
Thank you, Lucia, for bringing us together. If you're watching at home and you can see yourself, that means your camera's on. And so I would ask, our technicians may try to turn your cameras off, but if you could turn your cameras off, that would be helpful. So today we have the children's time, and I'm going to ask Emma to actually turn her camera on. And Emma, I see you have a special guest with you this morning. Do you want to introduce your guest?
Yes, this is Evie, my daughter. Hello, Evie.
Evie, it's great to see you. You know, we're in challenging times, certainly as a nation with the resurgence of the COVID virus. But boy, it can be a real challenge with children's programming as well. Even the local school district has over 100,000 children who are not yet able to return. But we've worked hard from the earliest days of this virus to try to provide ministry to our families and youth. And Emma, would you take a moment and tell us what services will be offered later today for our kiddos?
Yeah, later on, we'll be doing our Sunday school hangout at 2:00. We do that between 2 and 3. And today we're gonna be doing vision boards because, you know, as Martin Luther King Jr. said, I have a dream. And so we thought it'd be fun to do some vision boards and so kids can visualize stuff and, yeah, so that's what we'll be doing today. It's not quite the same as being together in person, but at least we can do it on Zoom together.
Great.
So.
Now, one of the visions we have at WHCC is really involving our youth to the greatest degree of possible. We have two of our teens, for instance, who are our video techs. And today we have one of our youth actually giving the message, if I understand. Is that correct?
Yes, we have Evie will be doing the children's story today.
Great. So Evie, take it away.
Thank you.
Okay. Peaceful fights for equal rights. written by Rob Sanders, illustrated by Jared Andrew Shore. We must pursue peaceful ends through peaceful means. Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Assemble, take action, create allies. Make buttons, make banners, make bumper stickers too. Boycott, boycott, boycott. Chant, cheer, call someone, campaign, camp out. Demonstrate, don't give up, don't give in. Educate, encourage, endure. Be fearless, fly a flag, file a lawsuit, have faith. Give time, give strength, give money if you can. Shake a hand, lend a hand. Have hope, be hope. Inquire, inform, imagine, invite. Join others on the journey. Join others in the fight. Knit a hat. Take a knee. Listen, learn, lead. Light a candle, write a letter, pass laws. March, mediate, meditate, motivate. Never stop. Organize, organize, organize. Parade, picket, post. Persist, persevere. Pray. Ask questions, never quit. Quietly do what's right. Read, remember, resist. Stand up, speak out, sit down, sing loud. Be silent. Strike. Turn up the volume. Unite. Vote, volunteer, keep a visual, be nonviolent, wear it, wave it, work for it, write about it. Explain change, exemplify change, respect change. You can only do what you can do, so do it. Be zealous. The end. Thank you for listening to the story. Have a blessed day.
Thank you,
everybody. I hope you can join us for our meeting today.
Thank you, everybody. Bye-bye.
Thank you so much, Emma, and most especially Evie, for giving us today's message. You know, folks around the country, when they think of California, tend to think of us as always being at the very forefront of issues of justice and inclusion. Now, sometimes that's true, but sometimes it's not. There's many reasons I add that sometimes it's not part, but in this Martin Luther King Jr. weekend, I'm thinking particularly about how in November of 1964, the voters in California passed something called Proposition 14. And what had happened is just a year or so earlier, the legislature had passed something called the Rumsford Fair Housing Act, which said that folks could not discriminate, especially around racial and ethnic issues, when it came to matters of housing. Well, immediately a group organized in the state and said, realtors and property owners have a right to sell to whom they want. And so they got rid of the Fair Housing Act, and immediately the discrimination kicked in. Well, Woodland Hills Community Church and other faith communities in the West Valley had been mobilized by Dr. King's rousing presence in 1961. So they started doing something amazing in the spirit of the children's story. They started dividing themselves up in order to document the discrimination. And first they would send out a young couple of color and ask if a property were still available, and if so, what price it was. Then they would send behind them a white couple. And guess what? The answers that each of the couples were given were very different. And because of the efforts of the faithful in places like Woodland Hills Community Church and synagogues and churches throughout the valley, they were finally successful in getting Proposition 14 overturned. It was a dark chapter in California's history. Well, every generation has its own challenges. In 1964, it was around housing rights, and today the struggle is around voting rights. Every generation has an opportunity to keep that dream of Dr. King's alive. So today, in our time of prayer, I would invite us to take these 2 minutes of silence to pray and or meditate and ask the Spirit to open our eyes to the way that we can be modern folks working for justice. So with that, let us pray. And as we do so, we will put up a slide here on our church campus that commemorates Dr. King's appearance 61 years ago yesterday. Amen.
Our special music today will be presented by the Chancel Choir. We will be singing Standing on the Promises. This traditional gospel hymn was written by Russell Kelso Carter in 1886. We will be doing a much newer arrangement of this hymn by Mark Hayes. The basic theme throughout is about the assurance of God's steadfast love and guidance for all of us as we journey through the hardships of life. Whether these hardships are in your lives today or last year or during the civil rights movement as we honor Dr. King's work or any time in your life or throughout history, I hope you can let the words in this hymn remind you of God's everlasting love and guidance.
Promises of Christ my King, through eternal ages that his praise is great.
Thank you for grounding us in those promises that really were the foundation in which the modern civil rights movement was built for so many. So thank you for that blessing. In this morning's reading from the Gospel of John, which you're about to hear, we get to hear a story that is told in not one of the other three Gospels. The story involves what is the first of seven miracles or signs that Jesus performs in the Gospel of John. Now, the Gospel of John is unique in that it is the only one of the four that calls these miracles something different. It calls them signs. And the authors of the Gospel of John use that term because for them, it wasn't the act or the miracle that was most important. No, what mattered most, scholar Ernest Hest noted, was that each of those signs pointed beyond themselves to what was being revealed through them. So what is the first sign that we're about to hear today? It was the moment that Jesus turned water into wine at a wedding in Cana. The story is short. In fact, all 11 verses contain just 216 words. And while all of them are important to one degree or another, there are five of those words in particular that give us tremendous insight, not only into who Jesus was, but how he and his followers were called to be in the world. And those five words come in the form of an observation shared by Jesus' mother near the very beginning. So listen carefully as Ethan reads John chapter 2, verses 1 through 11 from the Common English Bible. And when he finishes, then let's come back together and see how we can put those words and insights into action, both in our personal lives and in our world. Ethan, take it away.
On the third day, there was a wedding in Cana of Galilee. Jesus's mother was there, and Jesus and his disciples were also invited to the celebration. When the wine ran out, Jesus's mother said to him, "They don't have any wine." Jesus replied, "Woman, what does that have to do with me? My time hasn't come yet." His mother told the servants, "Do whatever he tells you." Nearby were six stone and water jars used for the Jewish cleansing ritual, each able to hold about 20 or 30 gallons. Jesus said to the servants, "Fill the jars with water," and they filled them to the brim. Then he told them, "Now draw some from them and take it to the head waiter." And they did. The head waiter tasted the water that had become wine. He didn't know where it came from, though the servants who had drawn the water knew. The head waiter called the groom and said, "Everyone serves the good wine first. They bring out the second-rate wine only when the guests are drinking freely. You kept the good wine until now." This was the first miraculous sign that Jesus did in Cana of Galilee. He revealed his glory, and his disciples believed in him.
Thus ends the sacred reading. Thank you, Nathan, for sharing today. So now that you've heard that passage in its entirety, you know that the five words that Jesus' mother spoke that I referred to were simply, "They don't have any wine." Let me take a moment and share with you why those words are so critical. The primary reason has to do with how Jesus goes about addressing the unmet needs in the world. It's a pattern that's consistent, not just in the miracles or sign stories in the Gospel of John, but in each of them. When Jesus moves through the world and finds a need, he rarely names that need for others. Instead, he waits until someone else identifies the need before then he gets involved. Think about it. I mean, Jesus was not clueless in today's story. He, like most of the guests, probably in the back of the gathering near the proverbial kitchen, would have known that they were running short of wine. And yet, he waited for his mother to name that need. Why? Well, you see, throughout his earthly ministry, Jesus was anything but a one-man show. Time after time, Jesus consistently created space for other people, including those disciples and his beloved, to step in, get their hands messy, and get involved in the actual process of meeting the need. He waited for others to come along who would do what Carol Lakey Hess called nudging God with their observation. And in that way, in the naming, in the nudging, Jesus' mother and Martin Luther King Jr. and you and I become co-creators with God in the effort to meet those needs. Now, thinking about how Jesus' way of being provides a perfect backdrop for us as we celebrate this civil rights icon known as Martin Luther King Jr. For you see, we often think of Martin Luther King Jr. in a very particular way, as a person who did great things. But we, fellow pastors of Dr. King's, see him a little bit differently. I think of him not primarily as a man who did great things himself, but rather as one who inspired and equipped millions of others to do great things as well. Let me tell you a little story of something that happened to me that influenced why I see him that way. Way back when I was in high school in the 1980s, the United States Congress was debating about whether or not to make Martin Luther King Jr.'s birthday a national holiday. So one morning I was sitting down at the breakfast table with my father, reading about the debate. And when I spoke up and expressed my hope that they would declare his birthday a national holiday, my father remained silent. Now that was unlike him. He was usually quick to share his opinion. So I did what any other self-respecting teenager would do. I confronted him. "What's wrong, Dad? Don't you support making this a national his birthday a national holiday?" "Well," he said, "I'm older than you, and I lived through that time, and I have a different perception of Dr. King." He said, "For you see, I remember that Dr. King would often go into communities, get people riled up, and then leave. 2 or 3 days later, there would be violence in that community. I know he talked about nonviolence," my dad said, "but he sure stirred up a lot of trouble." Well, it was clear that we were not going to agree that morning, so I did something unusual for me as a teenager. I let the conversation die. And while that conversation lasted only a matter of seconds, that memory is seared into my mind and will be with me for the rest of my life. For it was in that conversation that I learned what white privilege was, nearly 35 years before that phrase even became popular. For you see, what my father didn't understand was that Martin went into communities and had the audacity to do what Jesus' mother did in today's story. He named things that desperately needed to be named. His words nudged God and God's people into action, and they inspired millions of Americans, both Black and white, who had been asleep, to wake up and finally begin addressing those long ignored problems. Now, my father and many of those who had benefited from the systems that had been in place since the country's inception back in the 1700s called what came from Martin's mouth trouble. But I and millions of other Americans call it something else. We call it justice. And that is why today we honor this man who, like Jesus' mother, helped move things along by naming them. There's another easily overlooked detail of the story that can give us much deeper appreciation of what this weekend was intended to be about. And it has to do with those six containers or pots that went from being emptied one moment to being filled. Now, in speaking of those often overlooked containers, Linda McKinnish Bridges notes that those six pots were typically used for ritual cleansing in Jesus' day. And they represented what Bridges called, and I quote, the old order. Well, Jesus took those empty pots. He took that old order and produced something new and amazing, which he called overflowing vats of wine that never ran dry. And that, friends, is what Martin Luther King Jr. did as well. For as author and Presbyterian elder James McBride Dabbs wrote, religion at the time of Martin Luther King Jr. was a day and a place. Religion was Sunday, and it was at church, and almost everything else was simply life. Religion at the time was a curious, quiet, and inconsequential moment in the vital existence of most. Religion came around one day a week, but it didn't seem to have much to do, really, with the rest of life, Dabbs concluded. Well, in the late 50s and 60s, Martin Luther King Jr. came along and blew up that way of thinking forever. From the earliest days of the Montgomery bus boycott, organized in his sanctuary, Martin nudged the church to stop being inconsequential to the rest of life. And because of his work with groups like the Southern Christian Leadership Conference, the church is no longer inconsequential as it had been to social movements prior to the 1950s. The progressive church in particular is really the hotbed these days for those working on everyday causes like women's rights, the rights of the differently abled, LGBTQIA plus rights, racial and economic justice, economic rights, voting rights, immigration. You name the cause, and those faithful followers of Jesus are responding to the nudge that Martin provided right here at Woodland Hills Community Church 61 years ago. We are still keeping that dream alive. Now, I know in closing that for some, this weekend might seem like a hard time to celebrate advancements and rights. For as we listen to reports of the news these days, we are facing unprecedented efforts to restrict voting rights. And because of it, it feels more like 1952 than 2022. And many of us are feeling overwhelmed and discouraged. And if that's where you are this morning, I want to close my time with you by encouraging you to hold on tightly to the radical spirit of this morning's story. For that water into wine story teaches us that the world and the old order that has filled it for so long, it's always going to tell us that the jars before us are empty, that the world is about scarcity, that there's not enough to go around, whether that's human rights or basic services. That's what the world tells us. But our faith tells us exactly the opposite. For as Jesus' mother and Martin Luther King Jr. knew and reminded us through their naming and nudging, we followers of Jesus live in a world full of abundance, where there is not just enough to go around, but more than enough. And as Robert Brearley reflected on today's story, this joyous feast at Cana is still a sign to the church that we are to rejoice and to toast the world with the amazing news of God's grace, abundant. So my prayer, in spite of these setbacks, is that we will honor Martin Luther King Jr.'s legacy this year by doing just that, by toasting the world, even at those bleak moments, and sharing with it the abundance of good will and grace that can't help but bring God's reign of justice and peace a little closer, day by day. May it be so, and may we keep the faith. Amen. And as we keep faith and pull together as God's community, I will give you a time to reflect on today's message and for some an opportunity to extend your gifts to the ministries of this justice-loving community. Thank you, Larry, for that gorgeous musical reflection this morning. Friends, as we come together this day, we do what we always do, which is the prayers of the people, but we do it perhaps with even more vigor than usual. For as Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. knew, to walk through the world, both with its joys as well as its agonizing challenges, we must share those joys and tribulations with our siblings, for they are manifestations of God's grace and presence, and they help us endure. And so with that, we will open it for an opportunity for you to share your joys and concerns. And in this virtual age, there's one way that you can do that. If you can go to the chat window and take a moment and enter in either a joy or a sorrow that's on your heart, I will read those for our viewers both on Facebook Live and YouTube Live so that we can share those concerns with one another. So I'll pause for a moment and see if there is anyone out there with a prayer concern this morning. I'll jump in perhaps a little ahead of the group, and I'll raise a couple prayers for Clark, as well as for David. Both individuals had surgery on this past Monday and are in the process of recovering. So prayers again for Clark and David. I would also lift prayers during this time of isolation and social distancing for all of those who might be in homes where trouble or angst abides. Sometimes family life can be challenging under the best of circumstances, but in times like this, it can easily change to lashing out or abuse. So I pray for the families that there may be healing. And in that spirit, I'll note that a week from this Monday, we're going to be starting online a caregivers group for those dealing with the stresses and pressures of being a caregiver. You'll see more about it in coming days. So from Gina, Gina lifts joyful prayers for our choir and the ingenuity of our technicians who made this morning's number possible. Another prayer comes to us from Lake. She lifts up joy that to announce that Sue's cancer treatment is working. So we give thanks for the healing and, as Gina said, for the return of pieces of our community life. Are there other concerns? I'll pause for just a few more moments to see. All right. Seeing no other prayer concerns shared, I will invite us into a time of prayer, and we'll go to that time first through a sung call to prayer, Deep Peace. We'll then hold moments of silence. So for those of you who would like to participate in a communal moment where we share a bit of bread or cracker, and a bit of water, juice, or wine, you may do so. And then at the end of that time of silence, I'll lift words of spoken prayer in the form of the Lord's Prayer as well. Gina adds one more prayer as we go to prayer, prayers of thanksgiving for the tree nursery in Peru. So with that, let's go to God and lift up both the spoken and unspoken concerns. Gracious God, as we gather today, and as we hear the story of Jesus and the disciples and his mother, we realize that all too often in our day-to-day challenges, we're much like the disciples and Jesus' mother. We can only see the emptiness of the jars or containers around us. And because of that, at our greatest moments of need, we feel more connected to the spirit of scarcity than abundance. And that is why we give thanks in the face of these challenges, in the faces of surgery and of disease and of treatments and of loss. We give thanks for those ways which, when we choose to connect with you, that you remind us that the jar is not empty and that it is overflowing. And that proverbial jar comes in many forms. So we pause now to partake a bit of the bread and cracker or the water, the wine or the juice as expressions of your abundance to ground us. And as we partake of those elements and expressions of your abundance, we give thanks for all of those things with which you have blessed us that remind us that the vision you have for us is not of scarcity, but of abundance. That message came through so clearly in Dr. King's 1963 address, where he lifted up his dream. And that dream is alive two millennia earlier, when Jesus lifted his vision through prayer. And so to celebrate that vision, we pray now together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. I want to pause for just one moment, and we've started, as of 2 weeks ago, a new tradition where we don't do the announcements verbally in the service. They are streamed before the service during the prelude, and they're streamed at the conclusion of the service during the postlude as well. But I do want to pause for just a moment. We're going to put up on the screen a resource that'll remind us how we can stay connected to the ministries of this community. And on that next slide, you'll see you can stay connected by joining our email list by texting the capital letters WHCC to 42828. And by subscribing, you'll receive our weekly Thursday email and any other breaking news that comes along the way. And if you don't feel ready yet to sign up for the email list, you can visit our church website at woodlandhillscommunitychurch.org. And there, particularly on the updates page, you'll find the latest of what's happening. So friends, as we prepare to move forward, I was reminded this week as I was starting to react and become upset about the news that was before us, that, you know, I've grown a bit spoiled, and I've grown to the point where I expect others to do the work, so that when things that are disillusioning happen, I have the sense of entitled, well, why did this happen? Rather than seeing it as an opportunity to step forward and be called to participate in the work for justice. So today, as we leave behind our frustrations and our sense of entitlement about how the world should be, and as we roll up our sleeves to get ready to do the work ourselves, our closing song is by a wonderful musician, Carolyn McDade, and it's called "There Is a Time." And the time for working for justice did not end 60 years ago when Dr. King's life was extinguished, but rather the work continues to this very day. And you are called to be a part of that work. So with that, Lucia will lead us in our closing song, "There Is a Time." And so, friends, at the start of today's service, I talked about how as a Just Peace Church, I was trying the service to move away from images of wars and battle to describe the work for justice and inclusion to a different image of how that might be accomplished. And I want to close today for the benediction with a powerful words of observation shared by a ministry colleague of mine named Robert Brearley. And here's what he noted about how Jesus started his ministry and work and how we might go forth in ours. What a way for Jesus to begin his public ministry in John's gospel. It is called Cana grace, and it is worth a miracle because it manifests the glory of God, the very God who wants, even now, for the community to be a celebration of people. Imagine, he says, siblings in Christ eating together a meal on the back porch and laughing until the sun goes down. Imagine women turning the church gymnasium into a festive party as they share both gospel and food together. Imagine a new member's dinner at someone's home that ends with folks from all social locations hugging one another and giving thanks to God for the welcome they have received. In those moments in life, it can be called Canaan grace. So give thanks for everyone in your church and life who has a knack for throwing a party. What a way to begin a ministry and a movement for justice. So let's go forward and share the love, the joy, and the peace of Christ. And as we go forward today, acknowledging the challenges before us, we're going to use as our closing chorus today a foundational hymn of the civil rights movement, "We Shall Overcome," for it will ground us in the promises in which our choir stood today. So let's sing our closing chorus, and then those who would like to stay for the fellowship time can do so in this very room following the postlude.